Welcome to Lesson 6 on the Leadership Lessons. Today we're going to be looking at vision, inspiring a shared vision. Before I get into the lesson, I want to encourage you to go online and download the notes and then fill in the blanks as we go. I think I'll give you time to do that. And that way you can carry this work with you and this lesson with you into the future. Now, vision is something that's kind of nebulous. It's very subjective. And a lot of people wonder, what in the world is a vision? I remember when I came to First Baptist Church of Oviedo, which is now Cross Life Church, and they asked me, what is the vision for the church? What is the vision that you think we need to have? Well, it was impossible for me to articulate that, and I shared that with them because I didn't know the area. You know, all I knew, there was a lot of chickens downtown, and it's very difficult to get vision overlooking at a lot of chickens. And so I had to get the lay of the land and look at it and then pray about it. And so that begs the question, what is a vision? Why do you even have to have it? I mean, after all, every business, every church, they ask the question, what is your vision? And some people can articulate that and some people and some organizations cannot. So what is it? Why do you need it? How do you get it? How do you actually acquire a vision? And then how do you communicate it to others? Because as a leader, I not only need to have a vision, I need to communicate that vision to those that are following. Now, Leadership Magazine has said this. It says, every great work and every great person came under the influence of a vision that changed them and therefore changed others. And so a good verse in the Bible, Proverbs 29:18, where there is no prophetic vision, the people cast off restraint. And what this verse basically says is without vision, without knowing where you're going to go in the future, people kind of go their own direction. And oftentimes it's the wrong direction and even the sin. And so I remember in 1992, when George H.W. Bush was trying to run for re-election, he had a lot of things going on. He did a lot of pretty good things, I guess, in the past. And they kept hounding on him about this, as he put it, the vision thing. He didn't quite get that. And so what is a vision? How can we define that? Well, it's sort of like what Duke Ellington, the old jazz musician, said about rhythm. He says, if you got it, you don't need no definition. And if you ain't got it, ain't no definition gonna help. Well, that's pretty much the way it is with vision. But let me share with you what we're not talking about. We're not talking about what the Old Testament describes as a dream or a physical vision. I'm not saying that can't happen. But really, when we're talking about articulating a vision of an organization or a church, we're talking about a clear mental picture, really, in your mind and in your heart of what you believe needs to happen in the future. It's where you're going, kind of the goal that you're seeking after, and it has to do with really who you are. And so it's basically seeing, making the invisible become the visible. Well, let's start right now into answering some of the questions about vision. First of all, let's look at the value of it. Why do you need one? What do you need this to become in your life? Well, first of all, vision gives you passion. They often ask at a Greek funeral back in the old days, did the man have passion? Did the woman have passion in her life? I remember starting a church at Briarwood Baptist Church in Atlanta, Georgia. And I remember the passion that everybody felt for reaching that goal of starting that church, planning that church, building the building, and getting it going. Then, if you have passion, of course, vision would also provide motivation. And so oftentimes, we're not motivated in life, and it's hard. It's difficult for me to say, motivate you. You have to motivate yourself and allow God to do that as well. But so often we get to a line, if I can just say this hand is like the survival line. We get to this point and we're motivated. We're motivated to reach that, but then not much beyond that. I remember, again, when we started a church in Atlanta, everybody worked really hard. Everybody was out inviting people to church, inviting people to know Christ. They wanted to build the building. They were there helping paint the building. Then we got done. We got finished with the building. We moved in. We constituted as our own church. And it was like, we arrived. You know, we don't have anything to worry about. Now, let's just take a moment to rest and enjoy the result of all of our work. Well, we sort of hit a line there of satisfaction, of survival. And it was very difficult for me then to motivate people past that because they had reached their vision. Their vision was to build that church, to make it, to put it on that corner, and to make it a viable operational church. We had done that. And so, therefore, time to quit. Well, the Israelites were the same way, in a way. I look in the book of Exodus, and then Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua. They start into the promised land. What happens? They begin to conquer some of the people in that land. Once they do, the Bible says they begin to plant, they begin to harvest, they begin to just build their homes, and then they quit fighting the wars, and they allow the Canaanites to stay there. Why? Well, they reached their survival line, but not really totally in the promised land. And so C in your outline, it also gives you direction to go. Remember what happened to Paul on the Macedonian call. He was stopped right where he was. He was sent another direction. Then I believe that also it instills confidence in our life. I know that the most important role of vision and organizational life is to give focus to human energy. Napoleon Hill has said, "Cherish your visions and your dreams as they are children of your soul, the blueprint of your ultimate achievements." And so you really can't put a price on vision. Without vision, you're only going to go from step to step to step, day to day, and meeting the daily needs without any real focus on what God can really do in your life. Now, the question then comes up, how do we get that vision? How do we receive the vision? Well, first of all, A, in your outline, you prepare for it because you have to have a relationship with God. In order to hear the voice of God, that inner, still inner voice in your mind about the vision and what God wants you to do, you have to recognize His voice. I remember so many times calling up my kids, my grown children, and I'll say, hey, this is Dad. And they just laugh and say, yeah, I know who it is. Now, why would they know who it was unless I told them? Well, they recognize my voice. Why? Because I've been talking to them all their life. And so they understood what it was like and what it sounded like for me to speak to them. Well, the same is true with vision, prayer, anything about the spiritual life. Relationship is the key. Do you recognize the voice of God? You see, so many times we, for example, as a pastor, we want to have this great vision. And if you notice sometimes, many times, pastors have great visions and they always include them being very successful. You know, we're going to build this great hospital. We're going to build this great school. And we're going to do all these wonderful and great things. I'm going to have this great TV. I have a vision of having this great TV ministry. It always seems to center around what we want instead of what we hear. And so you have to prepare for it. Then secondly, you have to look for it. You have to look for the vision. And there's different areas where you look. First of all, you look within your gifts, experience, talents. Rick Warren has come up with an acrostic SHAPE. And each one of those letters in that word stand for something that will point you perhaps to the vision in your life and God's will for your life. Spiritual gifts is the S. God has gifted you the very moment that you were saved. So what are your spiritual gifts? Because God has given you gifts to accomplish the vision in your life. Then what about your heart? You know, you have a burden for something. Maybe you have a spiritual gift to teach, but now your burden is really for high school students. What about your ability? Letter A. That is the talents that you were born with physically the first time. Not born again, but born the first time. And then your personality. Are you introverted, extroverted, kind of in between? Your experiences of life. It's amazing how God builds on our different experiences in life. My wife and I planted a church in Atlanta, Georgia, called it Briarwood Baptist Church. And it's not surprising that God would lead me to that, even though in seminary, I really didn't have a burden for it. Back when I first really started growing in the Lord at 19 years old, I was a sophomore in college, a friend of mine and I went out to Bogart, Georgia, my hometown, and started a youth group there from scratch. So you see, I had a previous experience that led me to church planting. And then we want to ask really the purpose when we look within. We want to ask the purpose in life. You're going to find out through this lesson that purpose is really the key to finding out the real vision for your organization or for your church or even for your life. That is, what is your life all about? That's where the foundation is. If you know God's purpose for your life, then you can look toward a a vision of what he wants to do in the future. So what is the purpose? Then you not only got to look within, but you need also to look around. What is God doing around you? We had a vision a couple of years ago to put cameras in the high schools for security reasons in our local high schools here in the area. And so how did we come up with that? Well, we looked around us and we understood that there were shootings, killings going on in our public schools. Not necessarily, never happened in the Oviedo area, but it did happen here in Florida. And so we ask ourselves the question as a church, what's something big we can do and really helpful to the local school system? I contacted the superintendent of schools and he shared with me that in security, they need three things. They need people on site, guards, they had those. They need fencing. That's the key thing that they needed. But right along with that, they needed cameras. Well, we couldn't afford the fencing, but we could, we felt like, raise enough money to put cameras in both of those schools. And so with the help of the entire community, we got together and we raised $80,000 to put cameras in the two high schools, complete new camera systems, where all the police had to do was ride up to the school. They can punch a couple of buttons in their car and get the video screens of all the cameras within the school. So it's really a great thing, and God led us to do that. Why? Well, there was a real problem, and we looked around us, we saw the problem, and we met that need. Number three, you look above. You be sensitive, again, to the voice of God. How is God speaking to you? Now, you may say to yourself, well, I don't know the voice of God. Well, Henry Blackaby has said this: if you cannot hear from God, you're in trouble at the very heart of your experience with God. And so we come right back to the relationship. To have that relationship so close in the Word of God, in prayer, and in service for God, that you recognize God's voice. Now, what about sharing the vision? Well, I want to give you a couple of things here about sharing the vision. And then I want to give you an example out of the book of Nehemiah that Andy Stanley goes over in one of his books. And we're going to look at how to not only receive the vision, but share the vision at the same time. Because one of the keys to being a leader is not just having the vision, but being able to articulate that vision to other leaders and other people in your church. There's a quote there in your notes. It says, all great leaders possess two things. One, they know where they are going. And two, they are able to persuade others to follow. George Barnum, in one of his books, as a surveyor of America, said 98% of pastors have never articulated a vision. Now, our vision at Cross Life Church begins with a mission. And that mission statement is building lives that matter by teaching people to love, know, trust, and follow Jesus. That's what we do every day. We are doing something every day to accomplish our purpose being to reach our area and as much as possible the world for Jesus Christ. So then we look at the vision, because the vision is just coming, flowing right out of the mission statement. That is to share the gospel. We teach people to love, know, trust, and follow Jesus in order to share the gospel of Jesus Christ wherever we live, work, play, and go, so the sun will not set on the ministry of Christ, Cross Life Church. So what we do is our mission statement. Where we're going is our vision statement. And so there's a passage in the Bible, Nehemiah chapter 2, that reads like this. I sat during the night with a few men. I had not told anyone what my God had put in my heart for Jerusalem. There were no mounts with me except the one I was riding on. By night, I went out through the valley gate toward the jackal wall and the dung gate, examining the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down, and its gates, which had been destroyed by fire. Then I moved on toward the fountain gate and the king's pool. But there was not enough room for my mount to get through. So I went up to the valley by night, examining the wall. Finally, I turned back, re-entered through the valley gate. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, because as yet I had said nothing to the Jews or the priests or the nobles or officials or any others who would be doing the work. Then I said to them, you see the trouble that we're in? Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be a disgrace. I also told them about the gracious hand of God upon me and what the king had said to me. They replied, let us start rebuilding. So they began this good work. We see a pattern here in Nehemiah that really we see all throughout, not only the Bible, but also our lives as well. Nehemiah communicated his vision as a solution to a problem. So we sort of get the process that goes on here suddenly. We first of all understand that in this passage, there was an understanding. And that understanding was the nation of Israel had a purpose. And that purpose was to be the people of God. They were the ones who were going to write the scripture, sustain the scripture. They were going to eventually bring in the Messiah. And so the people of Jerusalem, the Israelites, recognized the fact that they had a great purpose upon their shoulders with God. But there was a problem. And the problem comes about anytime we're trying to reach a purpose, there's obstacles. There's problems involved. So he pointed out the problem. He defined it, the problem. He says, Jerusalem lies in ruins. How in the world can we be a testimony to the rest of the world when we're just in ruins? How can we be protected from our enemies from the outside if we're not for the ruins of the city? How can we do that? And so he pointed out that they had a real purpose, and therefore there was a problem in reaching that purpose. Then he offered a solution. He said, let us rebuild. Then he presented a reason, the why to it all, when he said, so we will no longer be a disgrace. So you see the pattern. Got it? We have a purpose. Our church has a purpose, reaching people for Jesus Christ. A problem comes up. Well, we can do this, but we've got obstacles involved. For example, building the building that we have right now as a worship center. We didn't have enough space. We didn't have enough room. Our campus was spread out. We were hurting in our ability to reach people for Jesus Christ. So there's a problem. And so the vision then becomes the solution to the problem. Now, I would disagree with some writers that would say this is always the purpose of a vision. Sometimes you get a vision and it has to do with your purpose and it doesn't answer the question of the problem because you don't have the vision for that problem. But most of the time, a vision comes up because there's an obstacle, there's a problem involved, and now you must do something to solve that problem. And that vision that you have, that God's given you, is the answer to that problem. So see in your outline, position and present your vision as the solution to a problem that must be addressed immediately. So it's not that you want to address it. It's not that you want to do it. What you want to do is convince people it must be done. And so the first step in receiving a vision, presenting the vision, is define your problem. Now, the first thing you got to ask yourself before that, again, that the passage does not address directly, what is the purpose of your organization? Why do you exist? You see, if people don't realize that you're important, no vision in the world is going to help you motivate them to get to the next destination. If the nation of Israel said, now, wait a minute, we're special. When did this come about? We're supposed to write scripture, you know, under the inspiration of God's Spirit. The Messiah is going to come from our family. What are you talking about? No amount of vision is going to help unless they realize there's a purpose and also there's a why in all of it. There's a problem here. Our entire walls are broken down and our city is unsafe. We have enemies out there. Now, on the other hand, if there were no enemies, they were saying, okay, well, yeah, we're in rubbles. We're going to get around to it pretty good, pretty soon. But what enemies? What are you talking about? Enemies. We don't have any enemies. No, there were enemies. So you can see there was a why. There was a problem to accomplishing their vision. Now, you look at it and you say, well, why does our organization exist? Then what is the problem your vision is designed to solve? What's the problem? And therefore, now you have, let us arise. Let us get all of our families together and let us rebuild the wall. What needs to happen in order to accomplish and solve the problem? Then you must be done. You must ask yourself, what must be done in the environment where God has placed us? And they were doing that exact thing. And then you look and you say, why is the leadership necessary? Well, everything rises and falls on leadership. So somebody's got to step up to the plate. So you define your problem. I want to look at letter A in your outline at the bottom of your page. It says the reason some of your great ideas are met with such resistance is that nobody sees them as solutions to existing problems. There was an evangelist on television years ago that decided that he was going to build these great, huge hospitals in his city. Three of them, as a matter of fact. And he had a great vision for it. Now, the problem was is that there were already too many hospitals in that city as it was. So when he built it, they were basically two-thirds empty for years and years and years. He had trouble raising the money. He had trouble getting it up, getting the buildings up, because people did not see, again, an answer to the problem. If there were no enemies for the nation of Israel, that I said, okay, you know, we need to do this, but after all, we can always wait on this. It's not that big of a deal. They need to see your vision of the future as a solution to the problem so that they can freely meet their purpose. One writer said this: the people living in Jerusalem had grown so accustomed to the fact that the walls were torn down, they hardly noticed anymore. Ever been in that position? There's something about your house that you never notice. It needs to be fixed, and it just becomes part of the woodwork, so to speak. They had ceased to be concerned. They learned to live with it. Over the years, they had lost sight of what could be and what should be, and nobody seemed to remember what used to be. Nehemiah's words were a wake-up call. In essence, he was saying, open up your eyes. Things are bad. We are in trouble. His fresh set of eyes brought a new perspective, and without much prodding, the people of Jerusalem took a fresh look at their situation. In that brief moment, they were able to see their city through Nehemiah's eyes. And once that happened, they caught his vision. Vision casting will always include an element of waking people up out of apathy. Vision casters rarely bring new information to the table. What they bring is an impassioned concern about an existing problem. They bring fresh eyes. Great quote. Now, B in your outline, before you offer solutions, you must help those you are leading feel the weight of the problem you are attempting to solve. It's been said that churches only build, for example, they only build when it's too late to build, when you are shoulder to shoulder with everybody else, when there is no room, when you've gone to three or four services and people are crying out for space, they're taking turns coming, then you say, okay, let's raise some money and then let's have an architect draw it up and then let's build the building. And by that time, it's 2 or 3 years later. And so for the vision caster, he has to cast the vision in advance. He has to see a step or two ahead of the crowd and then pray about it. As we've said all the way through this, get God's vision to solve the problem and then articulate to the people. Then, so first of all, you define the problem, but then secondly, we want to offer a solution. And that solution, your vision, is the solution. There's a problem that will go unsolved unless your vision becomes a reality. They feel the weight of the problem. They see the problem. Oh my goodness. You know, I don't know why we couldn't have noticed this before. It may be something like, for example, a church going into missions. So they bring missionaries from overseas and they share their films and their testimonies, and that helps. But then they bring people overseas with them for a short-term mission trip. People are in the pain. They see the pain. They see the burden. They come back. And of course, we've got to do something for these people. Let's raise the funds. Let's go on another mission trip. Let's build a building for them. Let's do something for them because they feel the weight of the burden. Then your vision, then we become the solution to lift that weight. Now, your vision in B is simply a mental picture of what could be and should be. Now, preachers do this all the time. How do you know anything about heaven, for example? You say, well, I've been there. Nobody's really been there, I don't think. You know, Paul was caught up in the third heaven. That's the only place in the Bible I can really think of. Stephen saw heaven. But basically, we understand heaven to be something that's in our future, and we trust that we're going there. In fact, we've staked our eternal destiny on Jesus Christ, and we feel like we're going to be with him and believe we'll be with him forever. But how do we know that? Well, because a pastor gets up and he paints a picture of heaven. He looks through the book of Revelation. Oh, it's going to be streets of gold, like transparent, but it's like gold color, but it's transparent. And there's going to be a throne in heaven, and there's going to be these jewels and all these, and this beautiful picture of heaven. What he's doing is painting a picture for you. He's drawing up a vision of what's going to be based upon the scripture. Now, whether it's something like arms reaching around the world, I remember drawing a picture here in our church about missions, about A.B. Simpson, who founded the Christian Missionary Alliance denomination. And it's been said that every morning he would get up and pray, and he would have a globe in his house, and he'd wrap his arms around the globe. Before it was over, he was crying out, "Lord, every creature, every creature." And so we get our picture of arms being wrapped around the world. We have word pictures that are going to make the vision come to life in those people's lives. Now, we've said there's a problem. We said there's a solution, but then we've got to present, number three, a reason for it, the why. Simon Sinek wrote a book called Start With Why. And as I read that book, I realized that the number one question everybody asks is, why are we doing this? If they understand the why behind it, they're going to stand a lot better chance of being motivated. A compelling reason will engage the heart. And you cannot effectively cast your vision until you are convinced that this is not only something that could be done, but something that should be done. And so, what is the why behind it all? Now, letter C in your outline. Why must you do this? Why attempt it at all? You've got to answer that question. Then D in your outline, the why behind the what makes your vision compelling. It's how we present the vision through the change that's going to be happening in life. Now, how would I do that? How would I present a new way of ministry, a new thing in ministry, a new vision to our church? And you can apply this anywhere in your church, your Sunday school class, or perhaps your organization, your business. First of all, I gather together the staff, and I make the staff aware of the problem at hand. Now, if our staff is not really compelled about the purpose of our church, nothing I say or anything is going to make a difference. Again, it's the purpose behind it all that is going to be the big thing in everybody's mind. But assuming, and I can assume this accurately with our staff, they know our purpose, I would go to the staff and I would present to them all these things, the problem, the potential solution. I'll probably knock around a few things. I'll start it out and say, what do you think about this? And they would begin to take ownership of it as we go back and forth and banter back and forth on the pros and the cons to doing what we're about to do in order to accomplish and solve the problem in order to get back to our purpose without obstacles. Then secondly, I appeal then to key lay leaders. Again, it starts off, got to be a leader, because the leaders are going to influence everybody else in the congregation. If they're not a leader, they may have a leadership position, but if they're not a leader, they can be there, but you have to know that they're not going to be a great deal of help. And so the lay leadership is so important. It's the worst thing in the world that can happen to a pastor is that he becomes the only influencer in the church. When everybody's just looking to one influencer, you have to disciple other people to think in a sense of at least think the same way you do about the purpose of the church, to agree on that with you and be compelled to accomplish that purpose. So you bring key lay leaders together, you present it to them, allow them to kind of fine tune that vision a little bit, and before you present it to the congregation. Then I would preach on the purpose of our church and the problem that we face, the obstacle that we face that's keeping us from reaching that vision or that purpose, and then present the vision to them. Well, then number four, preach on the solution and the vision, preach on the purpose and problem first, and preach on the solution and the vision. Fifthly, teach the problem and solution in small groups. The people need to be able to talk about it, ask questions about it, have input, and some of the things we may learn. We may change things up, massage things just a little bit. Then testimonies to inspire the vision. And the testimony should be based upon you're accomplishing the purpose. Now, this is what we've done in the past. This person received Christ. They have a wonderful testimony. This is another. Here's another. Here's a mission trip. These are the things that we've been doing. But now you all know that this is the obstacle that we have. And so we need to plow through it. And here's how we're going to do it. And so in conclusion, when you're looking at casting a vision, you have to have the vision first and you have to be sold on it before you cast it to others. And so you have to ask yourself the question, why are you here? What's your purpose for your church, for your organization, for your life? Whatever you're trying to get a vision for, you have to start there. Why has God placed you on this earth? Then why are you not reaching that purpose? Because all of us have obstacles. All of us have problems. Your vision, again, is the answer then, or the solution to that problem. And so then after you define the problem, you say, okay, what's the solution? Okay, now in order to accomplish the solution, here's the vision of what we're going to have to do. Here's our goal. Here's what we're putting out there. And then always you say, now here's the reason, the why. When we reach this vision, here is what is going to happen. And so let me just summarize things real quickly. Vision is the ability to see. That's awareness. It's the faith to believe. That's the attitude behind it all. I believe God has given me this, and therefore I'm sold on it, and people are going to see the passion in my own heart for the vision, and then the courage to do it. And that's the action we place behind that vision. Now, it's been said, in fact, Henry Blackaby, if I can just come back to him for just a moment as I close, some people say, God will never ask me to do something I can't do. I have come to the place in my life that if that the assignment I sense God is giving me is something that I know I can handle, I know it probably is not from God. The kind of assignments God gives in the Bible are always God-sized. They are always beyond what people can do because he wants to demonstrate his nature, his strength, his provision, and his kindness to his people and to a watching world. This is the only way the world will come to know him. And so the world needs to see the church in action. We are in action because we solve our problems with vision for the future. So I pray that you'll look over these notes. I pray that you'll review this, maybe this video many, many times. God has a plan for your life, a vision for your life, but you come to that place first, answering the question, what's the purpose? Then what's the problem? And then what's the solution to the problem? And work from there. God bless you. We look forward to the next session next week when we talk about the third thing that John Maxwell says every pastor needs. So join us then.